Let's get started. I'm gonna start rolling. Okay.
Okay.
I need to catch just a little bit of calm first.
Yeah. Do you have your fidget thing?
Hi, I'm Justin. It's too stilted. I'm already like not talking naturally. I don't need to like overthink it here. It's just when I start talking, like I'm fine.
It's
just gotta come from a place.
That's why I kind of think like, didn't you have a thing written out that you were gonna?
I'm going to read it.
Okay,
and it'll be fine. And when I say natural, I don't mean natural. I mean, I can say I'm fine. Like it's not weirding me out. Like I'm gonna say it in a nice reading voice. All right, I think I got it. I think I'm in that space. Hi, I'm Justin. When I was 15 in 2004, I met the Duggar family for the first time and began attending church with them at their home. I became close friends with some of the oldest Duggar kids and many others in that circle. While I attended, Josh's patterns of abuse first surfaced, albeit in a small circle of fellow churchgoers. At the same time, the Duggars were starting to skyrocket in their fame and fortune, and worked to keep their problems at home from interfering with their newfound opportunities. From 2004 until 2006, I kept a journal chronicling some of my thoughts and feelings during this time. I didn't know it at the time, but I was, and still am, on the autism spectrum. It would be kind of tough to fully understand the way that I processed and struggled with my upbringing without appreciating that I was undiagnosed autistic. My time with the Duggars taught me a lot about my faith and what I believed, and ultimately was critical in helping me start the long, painful process of leaving fundamentalist Christianity. I live a pretty normal life now. I'm married with a couple of awesome kids. I work a pretty standard job. I don't really think about the Duggars or my upbringing much, and have gone years without clicking on an article about them. A week or two before this recording, my spouse mentioned to me that Josh Duggar was expecting his seventh child. We talked about how concerned we were about his children's well-being and just kind of shared a moment of worry. The next day, news broke that Josh, who, again, was a friend of mine at one point in my life, was arrested for allegedly downloading child sex abuse content online. I knew people would be discussing and reading about Josh and felt like it was a good time to add my voice to the mixture in order to amplify what I thought was a good message. That this shouldn't be surprising, and Josh isn't where the problems end or begin in the Duggar family, or in the broader fundamentalist Christian movement. And that squeaky clean depiction of the Duggars that media outlets and networks like TLC spread were false and harmful to kids that grew up like me. So, anonymously, I did a post on Reddit expressing my feelings, and then was invited to do a Q&A on a subreddit full of Duggar snarkers and skeptics. It was fairly popular, and clearly was a topic that people were fascinated about. The response on Reddit inspired me to record this series and open up further, potentially at the risk of my anonymity and causing ripples among people I love and care about. In my view, it is worth sharing my story in a personal and vulnerable way because it might find its way into the ears of people that need to hear it. And even though it is a cliche and probably a little cheesy, I really do feel like it is worth it, even if it helps one person out. I'm joined by my wife, Julia, who also grew up in a fundamentalist Christian homeschooled family. Each episode, we'll read a portion of my journal, with certain names switched around and details redacted in order to remain respectful. And then the two of us will discuss what we've read and share our thoughts. Some of the things we'll go over in this series might be triggering or disturbing, so proceed mindfully if you're still dealing with trauma. We're going to touch on sensitive topics, dealing with things like child abuse and other forms of traumas that people are going to be familiar with. Our goal is to be serious and sensitive for the most part, because this is a serious matter. But at the same time, some of the things we're about to read can be fairly embarrassing, and sometimes there's nothing we can respond with except for apologies and laughter. And don't worry, we'll drop some tea and have some fun so that we're not too bogged down. All work and no play and all that. We invite you to reflect, cry, laugh, cheer with us as we discuss a topic that has impacted millions around the globe. Thanks for listening. This is episode 1 of I Pray You Put This Journal Away. Let's get started. Hi.
Hi.
How do you feel?
I mean, it's going to be interesting. I mean, this is a topic we talk about, you know, not the Duggar specifically, but everything kind of surrounding this and our experiences, our individual experiences growing up is something that we regularly discuss. And
yeah,
so
it's both natural and unnatural at the same time.
Yes.
This is definitely a topic we cover a lot, but you know, not often in front of a camera getting ready to distribute it to, you know, hundreds of people listening. Like, that part gives me butterflies, to be honest.
Yeah, it's weird. Like, a lot of this is stuff that you and a few other people know, or that, you know, maybe my own experiences, things that I've talked to like a few people about, but never publicly. And so it is a little, I'm nervous. It's a little weird, but
yeah. I mean, it is tough because you don't know who's going to hear it. You don't know who's going to, you know, be like, hey, I know that person in the podcast. And then, you know, be like, wow, I've never heard them think like that before. You know, oh gosh, you know, this is a revelation.
Mm-hmm.
And I think, you know, for me, it's just thinking about the impact that this could make.
Yeah.
You know, and how that kind of supersedes the comfort of anonymity and privacy.
Yes.
And all those things. So I don't intend to do this for a ton. I like, this isn't like a new thing. I don't think that I'm going to be doing this. It's not my new career, but
no, I think it's something that is hard to talk about. I don't know that we could talk about it indefinitely on a regular
Definitely
basis.
Definitely not, but honestly. But hopefully this helps.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, let's get started. One thing about this journal is that it's not just like a straight reading experience. There's a lot of like bullet points, diagrams, you know, nested lists, and sometimes some things that don't make a lot of sense to just reading. So I'm going to have to describe certain sections to you guys. And like I mentioned in the intro, we're going to, you know, pause and kind of give people pseudonyms and flip-flop some things around, you know, if it's going to be too uncomfortable. Our goal is to talk about public figures and events that either are public or probably should be public. But people who really are just kind of minding their own business, they can, you know, their names aren't going to get thrown out there by us. So, you know, we just kind of, that's, I guess, the way that we're going to approach this. So at the beginning of my journal, as you can see here, I started this in December 23rd of 2004. And the first thing that I did was take notes for the book that Rick Warren wrote years ago called The Purpose-Driven Life.
Yeah, I remember that.
Definitely.
My church had a whole...
Hated it, probably.
My church
did
hated
they,
it?
Did they hate The Purpose-Driven Life?
No, my family did not participate. My family was not... That was too mainstream.
Yeah,
but
Rick Warren.
The church that I spent most of my childhood in... They did a whole conference basically based on
The Purpose of
Life
and Rick Warren. It was really one of those Christian books that kind of became super mainstream for some reason. And like people were talking about it everywhere. And in you know, Dad, you got to realize, like, at this time, my family was kind of doing a shift from sort of being the most conservative people at a mainstream church to becoming the most liberal people at an extremely conservative church. So the purpose-driven life was one of those mainstream-ish kind of things that we were doing mm-hmm. as a family, but that most of the people in like the Duggar circles wouldn't have been doing and didn't like, because it was too, you know, it was too nice. It was too tickle your ears. They would say, you know, like it's just sort of like a surfacey thing. And they would often call these kinds of people buffet Christians, in mm-hmm. that they would pick and choose what they liked in the Bible, you know, as in like, oh, I like the stuff about love, but mm-hmm. not the stuff about chopping people up. So, yeah. And the Duggars saw that as a bad thing. They were like, oh, hold on, you take the good with the bad. The chopping people up part is very important, mm-hmm. and we're going to just celebrate that, you know, straight up. So anyway, enough about this. I'll just kind of get into it. So I have here just my notes and reactions to day one of the purpose-driven life, just saying, you know, what can I do to kind of improve my walk with God? And I said that, you know, I should memorize scripture, read the book, share what I've learned with others, ponder on it. Day two, the theme was, you're not an accident. And I think Rick Warren was just saying, like, God made you on purpose. You know, we all have things that we struggle with about ourselves. What are some things you struggle with about yourself? And so I wrote them here. I think they're relevant because this is page one of my diary. And I said, I am struggling to accept my singing voice, my athletic abilities, and my communication skills. Now, you guys will probably notice as you go through this that my written communication skills are actually not that bad. Like they're pretty good, pretty passable. The problem that I was having at this age was that I was having trouble connecting with people. And it was really difficult for me to have people's reactions to what I was saying line up with what I thought and felt that I was saying. And my body never really seemed to match what I was thinking. And so the ding on my communication skills wasn't that I couldn't use words. It was that just on a human level, it was really hard to get connections. Mm-hmm. And that bothered me. You know, people just seemed to have the wrong impression of me. And I never felt seen, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
So that it's just funny to see that on page one of my journal. The next one was day three. What drives your life? And, you know, I put in some things about my video editing, which was a common point with Josh Duggar. I loved video editing, graphic design, you know, tech stuff, you know, and I kind of wrote that here that those are my driving forces, that I loved fun, but that I want my driver to be my purpose that God has for me. And I'm 14 years old. Or was I 15? I'm 15, actually.
Okay, yeah.
When this was going on, I turned 15 in September.
I was trying to do some mental math in my head real quick.
So this is 15-year-old boy here. Day four was made to last forever. And I think it was just about like, what's your forever view mm-hmm. of things? Are you...
What's that phrase?
Store up your riches in heaven kind of a thing?
Or being, is it eternally minded?
Having
or
an eternal minded? Perspective.
Yes, or, yes.
Yeah. Those are all phrases that basically mean that you should be able to tolerate things like discomfort or abuse mm-hmm. or other things like that. You know, basically be sacrificial because, hey, it's going to be a big party. After yeah. you die, basically. I mean,
and the whole like purifying with fire trope that's kind of kind of goes into that as well, where it's like, you know, what you go through now is it's just preparing you yes. for later, and it's all for the best.
Right. And it's an important thing to take note of with this theme of abuse yes. because, you know, this is one of those important perspectives is that they teach you to be eternally minded and to kind of tolerate misery, sin, mm-hmm. violence, bad things. And often this leads to kind of perplexing things that people from the circle will say, like, you know, somebody going through an overpass. This is a real example. You know who I'm talking about.
Yes.
Going under an overpass and having concrete fall on your car and instantly killing you and your family. Mm-hmm. This really happened. And, you know, someone that we know's reaction was,
It was God's timing, clearly, because he took the whole family at once. Yeah, isn't that an incredible thing?
Right. Well, they're in heaven now. So that's not actually a tragedy, you know, or, you know, people like a robbery where somebody gets shot. And there's like this, I mean, not to rabbit trail too much, but like,
yeah.
It's just funny how that.
Yeah. And I think it can be a, I know we've talked about like control frameworks and stuff like that.
Yeah.
But a manipulation tactic of, well, this is all part of God's plan for you. So you should stay in this situation and accept this situation, even though it's abusive, because
you don't have the full picture. God does.
Yes. God's ways are higher than our ways, et cetera, et cetera.
You don't know what he's up to. He could be up to something really big that's going to pay off. Not if not now, then in heaven.
Yeah.
So it's a really hard one to debunk because, you know, really the only way to debunk it is to say, is to take an attitude that feels less biblical.
Mm-hmm.
And that's really hard to hold on to your faith. And also say, no, we're going to make some decisions that care for people now.
Yeah. Yep.
Anyway, a bit of a rabbit trail, but I wrote here, I will stop storing up stuff to just have. I should start encouraging myself and others to live today as if it was my last day. Which I actually kind of like. I still kind of think that way a little bit, but that's sort of the opposite of an internal perspective in a way, isn't it?
I was just going to say
I kind of feel like I missed the point in the best way. The next one was seeing life from God's view, which feels like a continuation kind of. And the verse was Luke 16:10a NLT. I was very sure to put the version.
I love that.
Attention to detail. I said, unless you are faithful in small matters, you won't be faithful in large ones. All these little things that you do are very important and crucial because you're basically just proving it. You're going to get that promotion, spiritually speaking, as long as you shine your shoes and pay attention to the little stuff. So what I wrote here was an example of how I was faithful in something small. And I said, I was in a gas station where there were suggestive pictures. I went into the men's room and mom went into the ladies' room. I came out first and I had the opportunity to look at the pictures, but I did not look at them. So that was definitely something I was very proud of.
Yes.
That, you know, I Nike'd myself.
Yeah.
Without anybody
looking. You
resisted
the devil's temptation.
Yeah. I don't know what it was, if it was Sports Illustrated swimsuit edition or, you know, honestly could have been anything to be frank with you. It could have been very innocuous, but I was very proud of it. That was a big victory for me. Life is a temporary assignment. Oh man, we're on a theme here.
Yep.
I won't bother with that one. I basically just the same thing, just saying, you know, I need to store, I'm not storing up earthly treasure. I need to focus on my treasure in heaven. And I wrote here, I also need to focus on my assignment, the Great Commission, which is an evangelical assignment, you know, saving souls, basically.
Mm-hmm.
And then here, I'll show you, is this. This is where we get our title. So I'll go ahead and read this. This is on like page 3 or 4. Note.
I love they have asterisks. Like,
yes.
You drew asterisks above and below it.
Above and below for emphasis.
Yes.
Note, if you are reading this journal and you know that you shouldn't be, I pray that you may exhibit the self-control to put this journal away. Even if you would be able to read this and get away with it, this journal is not meant to be read by you. May the Lord empower you right now, right now in all caps, to put this journal away. I'm counting on you to do the right thing. smiley face. Really, really tugging at their heartstrings there.
My gosh.
Yeah.
I should have tried that in one of my journals. Maybe that would have guilt tripped my brothers out of reading them.
Psyching them out.
Yes.
I mean, I doubt it worked for me. I think the first people to recognize who I am and like probably ID me are going to be my siblings, who most certainly stole this journal and read it multiple mm-hmm. times over. So, you know, hi guys.
Also, I have to give you props because your 15-year-old handwriting is gorgeous.
Yeah. So this is something that's kind of, I think, an unusual trait for people with ASD. From mm-hmm. what I've heard is that, you know, bad handwriting is pretty typical, but I, you know, there's no rule that says that that's has to be the case.
Mm-hmm.
I really modeled my handwriting after my mom's.
Mm-hmm.
When she would do assignments or write notes, I always thought she had the best handwriting. And so I would just really zoom in on how she did every single letter and just mimic it like crazy. I would fill up page after page after page, 8.5 by 11 by 8.5 by 11 of the letter A.
Oh my gosh, I did that too.
And at one point, you see how I have a cap on my lowercase a's?
Yes.
I spent about a week building the habit necessary to add that cap.
Oh my gosh. I did the exact same thing. And yeah. I also was obsessed with my mom's handwriting. I thought her handwriting was gorgeous.
And if you were to look at my mom's handwriting, mine is just a slightly sloppier version of hers.
Hmm.
It's the same thing. Yeah. But anyway, I'll read this. This is my first like full journal entry here, and it's dated January 3rd, 2005. Happy New Year! 2 exclamation points. Today was the first day of school for 2005. It was hard getting up this morning. I am used to waking up around 8 a.m. still, so it was tough running and everything at 6:15. I ate a quick breakfast and watched some school on HomeSat. Now, I was homeschooled, so HomeSat was a service offered by a Christian university that also did homeschooling kind of coursework. And you actually set up a satellite dish in your yard and received live teaching sessions from teachers who had like little studios.
I actually didn't know what that was.
Yeah, so I think my mom had it because high school was a little bit tough, you know, in terms mm-hmm. of like the advanced topics. So HomeSat is what we did when we got to like, I don't know, high school-ish. Mm-hmm. So that was HomeSat. I hate to confess it, but I definitely didn't watch HomeSat with godly diligence every single day that I was told to. I skipped out a lot. I even figured out how to wire the TV that was used for HomeSat. I actually took it apart and got a bunch of copper wire. And like, if you can just picture this, I just like stuffed the big TV full of copper wire
mm-hmm.
so that it had an internal antenna, and then hooked that copper wire up to the TV from the inside.
Mm-hmm.
So unless my parents took the TV apart, they didn't know that there was actually an antenna connected to the coax cable on that thing. And so basically all I had to do was have headphones on and hit the input button to TV. And I had like amazing picture. I could watch like mostly Good Morning America and Regis and Kelly or whatever was going on at the time. And I even had like a little fail-safe thing in the back where I could like tug on a little wire and it would disconnect, so my parents didn't know that it was hooked up to live television.
I was not that.
So that's what I did instead of watching HomeSat.
I just snuck the DVDs from my parents' room and pretended to do my school while I watched their old like Mission Impossible and like
from this Roy like the Rogers 60s?
Yes, like just, well, that's all we had because we didn't have a TV growing up. We didn't watch any like modern shows. It was all like really old stuff.
Yeah, you'll see some references in here to Roy Rogers and stuff. I mean, we had the pop culture of 1950s people.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. So anyway, continuing on here. So I watched some school on HomeSat and then worked some more. I was diligent in my school, I would say. I had some problems with my rebellious attitude, and my thought life was struggling too. To be clear, when I say my thought life, I mean like sexual fantasies and things mm-hmm. like that. I mean like picturing girls' bra straps or whatever was like the super hot topic at the time. And, you know, this
flipping through that JCPenney catalog.
Flipping through JCPenney catalog. I had a big book from JCPenney stashed under my bed when I was like six. It was like a whole system. It was like under my bed. And I think my mom found it at one point and was like, what on earth are you looking through all this? What are you doing?
Yeah, my mom would rip out the entire women's like underwear laundry.
My mom should have, because like I was on that stuff like a hawk. I mean, like at one point, man, you know, like that documentary we watched, Icarus, about the Russian mm-hmm. doping, mm-hmm. how the Russians had this really sophisticated way of sneaking like steroids to their athletes during the Olympics, which are really closely monitored. Mm-hmm. And they have sophisticated stuff. I had something kind of like that for stealing Sears like underwear sections out of newspapers before my mom brought it inside. It was like, go straight to the mailbox where you've got the, you know, the Gazette delivered mm-hmm. and just Mission Impossible style, take the two pages of lingerie out.
Yeah.
And it was all, honestly,
I mean, it's all granny panties.
It was like, mostly granny panties and like kind of mom style lingerie, which I'm not dissing at all. I was super into it. So, I mean, those were my formative years. So when I say my thought life was struggling, you know, maybe I was tempted to go, you know, swipe a JCPenney's, you know, lingerie section out of the newspaper or something like that. I did not have access to porn. I had never seen bare breasts at this point in my life. You know, I did not, the whole nipple thing was like a mystery to me, so to speak. If it was in classical art from like the 1700s or a statue mm-hmm. or like a nervous system diagram. Yeah. Yeah. I was on that.
Yeah. The encyclopedias were like much manna from heaven when it came to like just getting some basic mm-hmm. information or ideas about.
I'll tell you what my mom had. She had this big, giant Mayo Clinic book that was like, you flip through it and it goes through all your family's ailments. Mm-hmm. Boy, that thing had like a diagram of how to check yourself for lumps, like breast cancer. And that was about the most erotic thing I'd ever seen.
Oh my God.
As like a 15-year-old. Yeah, so that was stuff. But just to give context, this is about the level of lockdown we had in the house. There's nothing.
Yeah, no, my mom was like gluing little sticky notes over any naked, like classical statues and encyclopedias.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I remember I had a piano, one of my piano music books had a song from The Little Mermaid in it, and she like carefully, painstakingly cut out a little shirt.
For Ariel?
Include it for Ariel to just get that covered up. And
tell you what, Satan's he's everywhere,
you know. There's constantly a spiritual battle being waged
during the Little Mermaid.
Yes.
Okay, so in reaction to that, back to the journal, I said I had some problems with my rebellious attitude and my thought life was struggling too. I feel like today was sort of butchered. I will pray that tomorrow is better. The afternoon slipped by quickly. I did not do much of anything, so it was not a productive day. Tomorrow is a fresh start, a clean slate. The year is not spoiled yet. And as a reminder, this is the third day of 2005, so I'm glad that I hadn't ruined the entirety of the year by the third day. That would have been interesting. I said, I need to pray for my cousin, for his salvation. Because I mean, you got to realize I was extremely literal about everything and very sincere about everything. So mm-hmm. you know, if I believed that hell was real, I really believed my cousin was going to go to hell. And mm-hmm. I liked him. I loved him. Like, mm-hmm. I didn't want that. So, you know, I took this as like a literal thing that I was doing, that I needed to tell him about this stuff without offending him, without mm-hmm. like driving him away.
Yeah.
Before it was too late. So I wrote about that in my journal a couple of times. My rebelliousness, something I need to pray for. My thought life. And I need to pray for the new school year, especially for the Duggar family, especially Josh during his trip to Little Rock with Jim Holt. And I'm saying Jim Holt in his name because he was a politician, and I don't think it's a secret that Josh was campaigning with him.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the Holts and the Duggars were very close friends. And, you know, Josh was, I think, pretty involved as like a 15, 16-year-old here. Well, he may have been, if I was 15, he may have been 17 here. But he was pretty involved in that campaign. Like, this was probably, honestly, right after my very first meeting with the Duggar family.
Okay.
Because I wasn't going to church there yet. If you notice here in my prayer list is a pastor of a different name.
Mm.
And that was because we were going to like a more contemporary kind of Christian church. And then visiting, like skipping church and visiting the Duggars. And I don't remember exactly how we got introduced to them. I actually might not know. I think Mom and Dad pretty much just told us one day, hey, you guys know that family that has like 12 kids and counting or whatever their special was they did for Discovery, I mm-hmm. think it was. They were like, they live in the area. I think we'd always known they lived in the area. And it was like, you know, we're going to actually go visit their home church and see how they're doing. And like, you know, I mentioned that we were like the conservatives of a contemporary Christian circle, but yeah. the liberals of a conservative Christian circle. Mm-hmm. I think to me and my brothers who were older than me, we thought it was kind of dumb to go over to the Duggars at first. We kind of like snarked at them a bit. Like, they were the family that wore like the matchy-matchy kind of...
Yeah, all the polo shirts and jean skirts.
The red dresses with the big giant collars on them, you mm-hmm. know? Like, and like they all had like the permed kind of long hair. And they all like played violin or something freaky like that. You know what I mean?
Something freaky like that.
Well, my brothers and I had a really terrible band that we played. But it was like we were playing edgy rock music, like the Newsboys.
I don't know if you can be a fundamentalist Christian and not have a family band. Like, I feel like
that's true.
It seems to be like a kind of a prerequisite is that all your kids must play
yeah.
some sort of instrument. And
I do feel like the next evolution, though. So it was usually classical hymns and like music like that for fundamentalist bands.
Yes.
Things like that, which was horrible.
Oh, that was me. That was my siblings and I and everything.
Did you
and
like
was,
that stuff? No. Even at the time?
No, we hated performing. I loved playing piano.
Yeah.
But I loved doing it for me. I didn't like any time people came within 6 feet of us. It was like, okay, kids, get out your instruments. We're going to do a concert. It was so embarrassing.
My dad didn't have the patience to run a proper family band. I think he always saw these little families, like these little fundamentalist families, like get up and like perform. They all like tap dance and sync. And, you know, it's like really impressive. It's like the Von Trapp family from Sound of Music.
We were not. We sucked.
My family was awful. So I remember Dad putting us up in front of a church one time. And like we drilled for like every night to go up there. And Dad was like, he was like snapping his fingers, trying to get us to follow a beat. He was honestly getting really mad at us over this whole thing. But I don't remember what song it was. I think it was like some kind of rendition of This Little Light of Mine.
Oh,
it was like a jazzy version. Mm-hmm. Oh man, it was so bad. It was like, I'm going to try to do it a little bit. It was like, This Little Light of Mine, I'm gonna let it shine, like kind of jazzy. And we had this little thing like, let it shine, like backup singers. Anyway, I'm going into way too much detail on this, but like it was supposed to have harmony, all that stuff. We butchered it up there massively. I got to see all the blood drain on my dad's face in real time as we were just failing.
Oh, yeah.
Just nasal, just off key harmonies that just sounded like hands on a chalkboard. But yeah, we were not impressive. And so we resented. I thought the Duggars were silly for all their violin piano stuff and Josh's weird opera singing. It was just like, I don't know. I hated it, but.
No, my dad definitely had those aspirations. And like,
how'd those turn out?
Like, us just like being completely out of sync on our, you know, we had to take recorder lessons, which of all the instruments.
Recorder.
It's so random. But
my oldest brother did recorder.
Yeah, but I think it's like a homeschooler thing. I think
I'm
in the real world.
I'm curious.
I mean, I could be totally off on this. I just don't hear people gushing about how much they love playing the recorder.
Sucks. It's not even a real instrument.
No, and it's like, you know, as kids, we're not diligent.
You don't see accomplished musicians breaking out the recorder. Like, who's the yo-yo?
That's what I'm saying.
Who's the yo-yo Ma of the recorder?
Although, we took lessons from twin brothers, uh-huh. And bless their hearts, they were great. You know, they were actually great at it. Bless their hearts. We would show up and just have no shame about the fact that we had not practiced since the last lesson. And we were not good at it. And Dad definitely was hoping for a family band. So
I think reputation is so important in conservative fundamentalist families, you know. And I'm sure that we were just absolutely shaming our parents with our lack of skill. But
have such a large family, too. Mm-hmm. It's just like you're a spectacle.
Yeah.
Anywhere you go.
Right. But you need to be a good spectacle for the Lord. So, yeah. I mean, like, I feel like there's a lot of emphasis, at least in my family, of like just being these charming little ducklings that kind of walked in a row anytime you went to the grocery store or stepped out of the big 12 to 15 passenger van.
Yeah.
Ours was a white. What kind did you guys have? I had a white 12 passenger Chevy van.
So we started out with a 12 passenger van.
Mm-hmm.
I think it might've been a Chevy, but I'm not totally sure. And then we
those Dodge vans were really popular too.
Oh, I don't know. I'm so bad with like car brands.
There's a few different kinds of fundy buses.
Yeah. Then we switched to a candy apple red 15 passenger van.
That's very classic. Probably with a little pinstriping on the side. No pinstriping?
No.
Ooh, that's good though.
Thank God. It was already bad enough.
That's a little more modest.
I took my DMV license test driving that thing.
I feel like that's pretty good, yeah. I didn't have to do that. Wow.
Yeah. It was.
Yeah. All right.
Anyways.
Reeling it back in. So yeah, that's how we first heard about the Duggars. It was just kind of mom and dad telling us that we were going to skip a Sunday and go visit them. And, you know, me and my brothers thought that that was kind of lame and didn't really want to go talk to one of those weird families. I think I probably didn't feel this way as strongly as my brothers did, but probably wanted to snark alongside them.
Mm-hmm.
You know, as you could tell, I was super sincere and I didn't turn that stuff on like in one day. I had been going already for a little while the literal faith, sincere faith kind of track.
Yeah.
But I love to laugh. I love to make people laugh and, you know, loved that kind of very overt expression that I could kind of grasp onto. And so, you know, having a chance to snark at somebody was always fun, whether I agreed with it or not.
Mm-hmm.
So we went there, we visited, and this was like two houses before they moved into the big green, like compoundy kind of thing that they live in today, which I worked on, by the way. I helped build that thing. I actually probably didn't help at all. I probably broke things while trying to help, but, you know, I was on site at least. So there's a First Baptist of, I think, Springdale, Arkansas, was there. The big First Baptist church that was like just huge, millions of dollars for the building, all that. They had like this little crappy house next to like cow fields in the road. And it was a tiny old house.
Like what kind of square footage, if you were going to estimate?
Oh gosh, I don't know. It was like the, I'm not going to say the square footage of our house, but like half of ours.
Okay.
You know, probably single floor.
That's like what my family was in.
Yeah. No, people. It was like very.
Yeah.
Like, I'm not joking. You look at a room and like you're trying to find where to stand when you go in there on a Sunday. Like everybody was jammed in there. All the slick stuff that you see with the Duggars today, like the stuff that comes from money and like, oh, it's really smooth and color coordinated and all that. No, it was like NAMM over there at that house. It was messy. It smelled bad. I mean, it just, the air was stale and smelled of like toddler hands. You know, like toddlers after they like eat Cheetos and lick their fingers for like a full day, and like at the end of it, just everything about the hand is just gross, that gummy little hand. Mm-hmm. That was their whole house, had that vibe. And so it was a little gross and kind of overwhelming on the senses. Go figure. But like, you know, I went in there and there was something that was appealing about it. And that was the Duggars were just, it was a circus. Like I used to call it like the tornado. It was like Jedediah, Jeremiah, like the little guys, Jason, mm-hmm. you know, they were all really little at the time. They were toddlers. And there was just a pack of little boys and Joyanna. I think it was like a bunch of little boys and Joyanna. And it was just like, you know, the Tasmanian devil in the cartoon, you just see that little tornado going around. You may not know the reference, but like, it's just like a little dust devil going around and like demolishing everything in its path. That was like the little Duggar boys. And it was so cute. And immediately I just knew that these boys wanted attention from somebody so bad. Like anybody who's like an older boy or dad or whatever, like they were just like, give me attention. And it was specifically the boys.
Mm-hmm.
So like my brothers and I walked in and probably had two Duggars on each leg trying to like trot around.
Mm-hmm.
And it was just immediately all the stuff about them being dumb and like this perfect little goody two shoes family from the special was just gone. And it was just like cute. I mean, it was just freaking cute. They had one room that was like their school room, I think. And it was like a lab. Mm. It was a really kind of crappy little tiny room, but they had just rows of like computers with computer parts just like strewn about. And like, you know, the boys were like building their own little computers from stuff that Jim Bob got in an auction. Mm. Like Jim Bob is like an auction, like addict. And he even was back then. I don't know how much money he had back then, but like he was clearly like hitting up garage sales and flea markets and auctions nonstop.
Mm-hmm.
And he was just a big collector. He was like, oh man, I can get 50 of those things for $5. I don't know if I need it or not, but I'm getting it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that was his whole thing. So it was just constantly like, you go over here and it's like, yeah, a university was getting ready to throw these out. And we just grabbed 50 computer shells. And the boys figured out how to make 10 working computers out of all of it. And, you know, I remember playing with John David and probably had Josiah and Joshua and all the, or not Joshua, but, Joseph mm-hmm. and some of the others, like just looking over your shoulder. And we were playing like Sim City and stuff like that, or mm-hmm. Frogger or whatever they had installed. And then Josh over at his workstation, he had the like the creme de la creme, super nice Mac that was like
mm-hmm.
nice. It was new. It
was it one of the multicolored ones?
No, it wasn't an eMac. I think it was like an all-in-one. I mean, it was 2004, 2005.
Okay.
Whatever they had going on for like iMacs at that time, they had. And it was super nice, slick. Like this was like probably brand new.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know the story on it, where it came from or whatever, but they were clearly investing in Josh's video interest.
Mm-hmm.
Because I think like from the early specials, Josh just was like, whoa, you know, yeah. This stuff is great. Like, I love this kind of thing. And so he was like showing me and I was just hooked. I was like, like you and me are friends now.
Mm-hmm.
And we would just kind of sit off to the side and just talk. you know, he would be like, you know, going over all the specs on this thing, how much RAM it had or whatever, and like so and so forth. And I was just over there just like, oh, well, you know, mine at home has this and blah, blah, blah. And I mean, I wish I could have one of these. Mine is a Windows. Like the Macs are really expensive. Like maybe my dad will let me borrow one from work sometime, but like, oh, I'm so jealous. This is so awesome. And then he's like, yeah, and check out this camcorder I got. And he's got, yeah, I don't know what the, like the camcorder of the day was, but you know, he pulled it out and it was something that I'd seen in like some, you know, catalog or whatever. And I'm like, oh my gosh, that's so cool. You know, I'd love to like do some stuff with you, like maybe some videos or movies. Maybe we can make a movie for the San Antonio Christian Film Festival.
Oh gosh.
Did you ever watch any stuff from that thing?
I feel like, well, weren't like the Fireproof and like
all those horrible church movies?
The Kirk Cameron's
pure flicks.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't know if those were there. We didn't really keep up. Again,
this was Doug Phillips.
I literally pretty much didn't watch any movies until I was like 14 or 15 year old.
Wow.
14 or 15 years old. And then it was like very a very old Lassie show that we're watching or something like that. Like it was only as a family, like we would all sit down and watch something together.
So your story of like you and movies was similar to like me and women's underwear. In a way.
Yes. And then I had to sneak DVDs and pretend to, you know, be doing my schoolwork to.
Very similar tracks we were on. So where were we? San Antonio, Doug Phillips, who's, I mean, sure we'll talk about him at some point.
Vision for him.
That whole thing, which was just this was at its peak.
Yeah.
I mean, that thing.
We used to get their catalog and stuff.
It was kind of an empire.
Yeah.
At one point, like everybody had those things,
mm-hmm.
and it was just nonstop.
Mm-hmm.
Honestly, I hate it because like I read a bunch of Vision Forum stuff, at kind of the wrong time, like as I was becoming a teen. So, you know, if there's anything super cringeworthy in my journal, that's like m'lady or like chivalry or madame or maid or whatever, like that bull came from Vision Forum. It's not like, it wasn't neckbeard at the time. It was like me trying to like literally keep up with the Vision Forum aesthetic of maleness.
Bless their hearts. I do not miss all the homeschool try hard boys. Just like
it's pretty attractive,
referring,
I imagine,
to every girl as like mademoiselle or milady.
Did you get called mademoiselle?
Yes, many times.
What did you think of that?
Not highly. It wasn't my favorite.
Yeah, I can see that.
It's a no for me.
It's a no for me. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that was a big thing, but you know, I think it was that film interest and all that. And like, oh my gosh, Josh has like really cool toys and like he has access to all this cool stuff. And, it may have even been one of the first times we talked to them that, like, I don't know if it was my dad or somebody like that, but we were looking at the computers as boys and dad did kind of that classic patriarchal thing of like kind of saying a bold statement that might, like, I couldn't imagine doing and just being like, bruh, making everybody uncomfortable. And his thing was standing behind us at church when Josh is giving me the tour of the computer and saying, what kind of filter you got on that thing? And I'm not joking. Josh's face, like he gulped. He did a visible gulp because my dad and I talked about it later. And Josh is over there like, oh, well, we got this, you know, like we've got this like whole system. It's impenetrable. You know, it's like, it's real hard to work around. Some quality product we've got installed on this machine. And it was, good.
And maybe just clarify what you mean by filter for anyone.
Filter meaning like at the time it was really, and I think still is really common to install, you know, this admin level software or sometimes hardware,
mm-hmm.
Like Pure Eyes or I think, which is like a total hate group, but like the American Family Association mm-hmm. had one that was pretty popular at the time. I'm sure Focus on the Family did. Like, it was a real common product to give to Christian households was internet filters.
And you could set up the thing where it would email some family friend or another person if you looked at anything
inappropriate. That was a whole nother subset of that, which was accountability software, which is a whole nother thing for mobile phones and everything else. But Josh was clearly always like bleeding edge on the tech. Mm-hmm. You know, he was always like really nerding out about it, especially with me, because I really, that was what kind of brought us together. Mm-hmm. And yeah, no, he gulped. And it was so funny. And that's about like where this journal entry is, was probably like a week after that, or, you know, a couple of days after that, maybe even the next day. And I remember, you know, after meeting Josh, it was like, okay, well, he's doing the campaign with Jim Holt. He's like, definitely wants to be a politician. Like, mm-hmm. this kid is like, talks to grownups easily. Mm-hmm. You know, I kind of was like, thought he was pretty cheesy and fake, but I was also kind of jealous of like how smoothly he could talk to people.
Yeah.
Whereas I'm over here like pacing in circles in a room for 2 hours just to try to practice a basic conversation and try to memorize enough scripts so that I could like branch during a conversation mm-hmm. and still be funny and be the persona that I wanted. You know, so I hated, cringed, and probably was a little jealous of Josh's abilities there. But he was working for Jim Holt. And I think the Sunday before I wrote this, I said, you know, I'm going to pray for Josh here. You see where it says during his trip to Little Rock with Jim Holt.
Yeah.
It was probably for a campaign event.
Okay.
Yeah. Because he was working on this. And his other thing too was that he was betrothed to somebody that will be unnamed, but was in the church. And I think it's kind of known in the circles who it is, but mm-hmm. you know, she's not a public figure. I don't, you know, we'll just leave it be mm-hmm. assumed. But yeah, he was betrothed to her, and that was kind of a factor. They weren't really like romantic. Like, I never saw, it's not like a typical boyfriend girlfriend where you're like,
no, yeah. not at all. Courtship and betrothal is very,
yeah. It was like they would go stand near each other for a second and kind of do a forced smile.
Yeah.
Kind of stuff. Yeah. But I never really saw them like excited to be around each other, or like she was probably the more like energetic, enthusiastic kind of mm-hmm. person. But he always seemed kind of standoffish to me and just like not very like comfortable with it. Very mm-hmm. proud of the status of being betrothed.
And you said he was what, 17?
17. Oh. Yeah. I believe he was 17 because he's just a couple years older than I am. But yeah. It was weird. Like looking back especially, I'm like, what are you kids doing?
Yeah. Yeah.
Like they clearly didn't have anything.
Yeah.
I have a page here which I'm not going to bother reading because it's offensive and it not intentionally so. So basically I wrote down what I thought was like some funny exchanges that my brothers and I were having at a random time during the day. You know, like they were doing voice impersonations and funny like little things and mm-hmm. they were not racially appropriate and they were not, you know, decent. Not the kind of thing that, you know, you want to laugh at, but you know, I look back at that and I don't ever remember having any real racist thoughts or like, in fact, I like was really bothered by racism.
Yeah. Yet
somehow I thought that like a lot of these jokes and things weren't hurting anybody and were really funny. And I think that was actually pretty common in a lot of fundamentalist groups to have this underemphasis on like sensitivity towards race, towards, you know, anything.
No, I literally thought until I reached adulthood, like race was not a conversation. It was something that was so simplistic, you know, oh, well, we don't have, you know, slavery anymore and civil rights happened. So, you know,
right.
It's just not a thing anymore.
Yeah.
And denial. There was so much. Yeah. You know, I look at things that my siblings and I would play. You know, we were very into, like, history.
Oh, boy.
Yeah. And things that we just, like, you know, we weren't intending any harm or anything like that. But looking back, it's like, that is so, like, yeah, inappropriate.
It's kind of 101 with your kids, you know?
Yeah.
Like, having conversations with them about things like this. And it's such a disconnect for me because, you know, on one hand, as a little boy, I would read about somebody like Harriet Tubman or whatever. Mm-hmm. And just, like, I remember I would cry.
Mm-hmm.
I would cry. And, like, that stuff mattered to me from an early age. But at the same time, there's just that disconnect because, like, we were consuming also a lot of really old shows
that are, yeah, that
pretty racist they and inappropriate.
Are very racist.
Sexist.
Yeah.
Like, it's really hard to watch those today.
No, I mean, I know we've sat down a couple times and tried to watch a couple episodes of a show that we'd watched when we were kids, and we ended up turning it off because we were just like, this is so offensive. And
yeah, and just being worried about our kids, like, repeating some of the stuff. Yet it was just not a big deal for us growing up. And I, like, most of the people that I knew watched that same stuff, and, like, we could all quote it to each other. It's like new media was bad because it had, you know, cleavage or whatever. But, like, old stuff where they buttoned up but were racist was fine.
Yeah. And, like, the curriculum, we were homeschooled.
Yeah.
And our curriculum was very whitewashed. There was a lot of focus on how godly these various, you know,
Christopher Columbus.
Confederate. Yeah. Christopher
basically
Columbus.
A missionary.
Yeah. Basically a missionary. Confederate generals. You know, so godly.
Miles
chapters
Standish,
focused on them.
Robert E. Lee, Stonewall Jackson.
Yeah.
Man, those guys were awesome.
I mean, I remember, like, Gods and Generals.
The movie?
Yeah, the movie Gods and Generals in Gettysburg. Those were very popular in our homeschool circle. Yeah. We had, there's a big overlap, too, with, like, Civil War reenactment.
Oh, boy.
Which is just really uncomfortable, like.
Southern cosplay was
huge. Yeah.
And I grew up a little different. You grew up on the West Coast.
Yeah.
I grew up in the Deep South. Mm-hmm. You know, obviously it was near the Duggars, so Arkansas.
Yeah.
And, you know, I had family in even more rural areas than Northwest Arkansas, which is actually, like, you know, more urban than most of the surrounding parts.
Yeah.
And so for me, like, there was tons and tons of racism around me. That, you know, I knew, and I always knew to be like, that's not nice or that's bad, but, like, it was kind of expected.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't shocking to hear somebody say the N-word when I was, you know, growing up. That was just a bad word that you didn't use, you know, when I was a kid, and it was hurtful. But, like, you know, I knew people said it, and it wasn't shocking to me. It was just like, well, we don't say that. And yeah, the whole, like, South shall rise again, like, Southerns, it was the war of states' rights.
That's what I heard growing up. It was actually about states' rights.
The Southern
slavery.
Military was full of godly men, like, all that stuff. But so anyway, I just wanted to note that because on these pages, it's some pretty, like, cringy, really problematic stuff here. Like, and I honestly thought it was hilarious and had no... I don't have any recollection of thinking this was bad.
Mm-hmm.
And then here you can see on these two pages, I was clearly trying to memorize all of the Duggar names and ages. And so I had written them down. So Joshua was, he was 17. The twins, 15. Jill, 13. Jessa, 12. Ginger, 11. Joseph, 10. Josiah, 8. Joy Anna, 7. Jeremiah, 6. Jedediah, 6, Jason, 4, James, 3, Justin Duggar, 2, and Justin was the youngest. Oh, nope, sorry, there was also Jackson.
Mm.
And I didn't have an age on there, probably because he was less than a year old. Yeah, he was probably either 1 year old or less than a year old at the time. But Johanna was not there yet. And she was somebody that her whole... birth was actually, like, covered in a special.
Okay.
And so I got to see that. I got to see, I mean, not the birth, obviously, but, like, I was present when that crew was around and doing that whole thing.
And I'll just add in before you read this, like, you know, I didn't grow up watching the Duggars.
Mm.
For anyone listening, like, I knew who they were. I remember my mom showing me a clip or two of maybe one of their specials.
Yeah.
But most of what I know about them is from talking to you or what I've, you know, seen online, basically. Mm. I really don't have that much familiarity with them for context for anyone.
Yeah. And before meeting them in person, I don't think I'd ever watched one of their shows. To date, the most that I've seen is either things that the Duggars themselves watched with me, mm-hmm. and showed me, kind of forced to watch. Do you know what I mean? Like families get together and like we're all like,
yeah,
eating hot dogs and hamburgers or some non-pork product for the Duggars, because they didn't eat pork.
Oh, really?
They didn't. We can get into that later, but it was okay. Part of their, what do they call them? Personal convictions.
Okay.
So they had like personal convictions about things like pepperoni and, I heard such snark from the kids. Like just about the disgusting things I was eating if I ever had like pepperoni pizza in front of them.
Mm.
You know, stuff like that. But yeah, they very much were like, hey, if you want to be a Christian and just stick with like New Testament standards, great. But we're gonna go full Old Testament on stuff. But the funny thing is they didn't. I don't know. They just kind of picked and chose like stuff to go with. I mean, they were by no means like, it was just weird. I don't know. It's hard to explain. I imagine a lot of this comes from Bill Gothard and IBLP.
Yeah.
Honestly, in ATI. I'm sure if you dig through there, there's explanations to stuff like the pork thing,
mm-hmm.
or the whole thinking. They were very, very strict with like conforming to IBLP stuff. That was like their nexus as far as their beliefs
went. Okay.
Yeah. Should we jump into this? Gonna be a hot topic. It's about to get spicy. Heavy sarcasm there. It's very much about to not get spicy at all. It's gonna be pretty G-rated and pretty innocent. Dear journal, this is kind of a secret. I have met a special person who is really neat.
Really neat.
She is really neat. She is younger than I am. Important criteria, younger and shorter.
Oh my gosh. Yeah.
Had to be. I mean, how can you be the head of the household if...
Oh my gosh, I forgot about obsessing about that. He has to be older and taller.
So she's younger than I am. And she is very nice. I haven't officially introduced myself to her, but we have passed a couple of words. I have for some time been wanting to have a family, be a dad, be a husband. I am not saying that I'm going to marry this someone. I am only 15.
I love that you're reminding yourself of that by underlining it.
I think I'm having to hold myself back here. The truth is, I'm just being super thorough and like detailed, even with myself. Like, mm-hmm. you see, like me say, wanting to have a family, i.e. be a dad, be a husband.
Mm-hmm.
Very important to be detailed. So I am only 15, but when I'm old and mature enough to start courting, I would like to court someone like this young lady. She is quiet and soft-spoken, unlike me. Opposites, right? That's important. She loves children. She is very gracious and has a gentle spirit. I have met girls and young ladies who have talked a lot and were very flirtatious with guys.
Here we go with the slut shaming, Justin.
For the record, this is pretty embarrassing. This perspective. Even if they were pretty, that type is not for me. This young lady has not been like that with any guys that I've seen or with me. A virtue. She has a great family and she is a Christian. I wonder if I am good enough to even talk to someone like that. I see all of my dirt, quotation marks, and quotation marks, grime. And I wonder if I am good enough. I hate being a hypocrite. I hear stories of young ladies who have married wonderful young men, only to discover that their man wasn't so loving and good after all. I don't want to be a liar to whoever I court. I want to be honest, even if it meant giving up someone like this young lady. I love her family, her parents, and her siblings. But if I was to talk to her now, they might think I am trying to flirt with her. I would like to get to know her a tad more, but I don't want to do anything improper. Another thing I appreciate about her is her modesty.
Oh, no. Trigger warning.
She wears modest clothing, and that makes her that makes me see her character even more.
Oh.
I wonder what she thinks of me. Has she noticed me? She has smiled quietly at me a couple of times when I've been joking or laughing with others. She even spoke to me in response to a little joke I had once. Besides that, I've no idea if she thinks I'm funny or what. I basically, at this stage of my life, and now to a certain extent, really struggle with knowing what people think and struggle with subtext and like understanding. I really had a reliance on like explicitness, like tell me what's going on, otherwise stuff is going to fly over my head.
Yeah,
you know, and so that's a little bit of a factor here, I think. Besides, I have no idea if she thinks I'm funny or what. I wish I knew. I don't think I can talk to her because she might not like me, or her dad will boot me out. She is his oldest daughter. So there we go. Sleuths, put on your hats. It's gonna be a tricky one to figure out. I think that I need to wait a few years, and if the Lord says to me that she could be the one for me, then I will begin a friendship if my authorities approve. I just pray that if it is her, that she will wait for me because I am waiting for my wife. Justin.
I love the emphasis on, I say that sarcastically, but the on authorities and making sure,
mm-hmm.
you know, that you're worthy of this thing and that you've been approved to take such a basic step. But
yeah,
in that circle, and I experienced this a lot growing up, yeah. too, it was such a big deal to just talk to someone of the opposite gender.
Yes. Everything was sexualized.
Yeah.
Honestly. Yes. It's funny because you think this is a desexual, like in their minds, this is a desexualized, yes. environment.
Oh my gosh.
They're like, we took it all out. There's no sex anywhere. We no, cleaned
it's,
it.
It's
just full of it.
Yeah.
Everywhere you turn.
Every rule and action and everything is just completely wrapped around and obsessed with sex.
From small children.
Yeah.
And this is important.
Yeah.
From very, very small children, even babies.
Yeah. Yeah, young girls being told to not cause men to stumble. Yeah.
You know, like kids going around, you know, buck naked or whatever, like kind of stuff that you normally think of as pretty innocent, you know, was treated with like a sexual seriousness.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And there was this idea that, you know, everything was an opportunity. Like, friendship. The reason I was like, I might start a friendship with her.
Mm-hmm.
It sounds stilted, but like what I had heard and was taking very literally was the idea that you don't just talk to girls.
Yeah.
And if you do, it's got to be real low key, mm-hmm. brotherly. It's got to be like devoid of anything nuts. You heard me saying like I didn't want people to think I was flirting because that was bad. That implied butting in to God's will, you know, maybe she's for somebody else. She belongs to someone else.
Yes. Emphasis on that for sure.
I mean, her husband's out there somewhere in the matrix and like, you know, you don't want to like.
Yeah. Yeah. And she belongs to her father.
Yeah.
You know, and you need to like go through him to have any access or whatever.
I mean, by their logic, like, yeah, dad hasn't signed the title over.
Yes.
You know,
it's pretty, it's messed pretty up. Fucked up.
Yeah. It is, yeah, absolutely. That's a great point. I've kind of lost my place a little bit here, but yeah, no, everything, yes, over-sexualized, including friendships, mm-hmm. and, you know, it was seen as, like, kind of foolish territory if you were just to have a friendship with a girl, because what's the point if you're not looking to, you know, proceed towards righteous consummation?
Yeah.
No point. Other than seeking God's will, of course.
Yeah.
So that's evident here. Mm-hmm. Very evident.
Mm-hmm.
I'll go ahead and read the next one. Should we go? Go ahead. Okay. So this one is a follow-up. So clearly I had big plans. I was planning to talk to this girl. I was just kind of like struck. I had, and it should be clear that this is Jana Duggar at this point, right? I had the hots for Jana Duggar. I just did. I thought she was perfect by the logic that was set forth for me, which... you'll notice this a lot in the journal. I'm kind of using words that I heard to describe me, to describe mm-hmm. myself.
Yeah.
I hadn't really discovered who I was. Yeah. So things like diligent, you'll hear a lot going through this. You'll hear me say things like, I'm just too loud or too noisy or too outgoing. I'm actually kind of a quiet person. Mm-hmm. Like, I know I'm talking a lot in this podcast, but I'm to myself a lot.
Yeah.
I'm not really super outgoing, like... the interactions with people drain me, you know, mm-hmm. stuff like that. But in, you know, because people had told me I was Mr. Outgoing guy.
Yeah.
I looked at her and I went, well, if me equals outgoing and opposites attract, then the quietest person that I think is cute has got to be perfect for me. And Jana Duggar was just like, you could barely get her to say anything. And when she did, it was almost a whisper, like just super quiet. And she was a pretty girl. I thought she was like really like legit attractive. Mm-hmm. Like I was like, you know, in a holy righteous way, you know, thinking that she was great.
Mm-hmm.
And so to me, it was just like all the criteria fell in place. The checklists were.
Yeah. Checked. It does feel very checklisty.
Yeah, it you does. Know, I mean,
that was such a big, I think that's just another one of those things that's huge in these circles is like, you know, focus on character qualities and make your list of, you know, what you look for in a future spouse.
For people who don't believe in science, they sure tried to like science the shit out of everything.
I know.
It's so weird and unnatural now, isn't it? It's just unnatural now. And I'm not saying that to snark at people who are still in it, who are like living this way. Like they're not fools. They're not idiots. You know, they shouldn't be embarrassed by this. It's just, it isn't the way that the world really works.
Yeah.
And it's not how we ourselves work. So like, there's a constant kind of like stepping on your own human nature in order to conform with these very unnatural frameworks.
Yeah. Like you would maybe... this framework would be better suited for, you know, finding a business partner or something like that, where it's like, I need a business partner with these things. But, you know, courtship, how it was done, how I experienced it and how, you know, people in your circle, were you ever in a courtship?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. So we both experienced
one. Yeah.
That. Yeah.
That was interesting.
Not very personal at all. Not.
No, man, I just panicked out of it. Like, it was just ultimately too much.
Yeah, kind of same.
I feel bad for her, honestly. I kind of just, like, ditched her hard.
How did you break up with her?
I told her dad.
I broke up with him over the phone, and I didn't even know that was, like, a thing you're not supposed to do. But I was like, I cannot do this. And I just like called him on the phone and told him.
I was basically like,
and talking. I told my parents and they were very upset.
I honestly, I feel so bad. I played it just by the book and had no clue that I was like not putting any heart into any of this. I was just sort of like just sweating, trying to just be very literal and conforming with every single step that they ever told me. I mean, if they told me to jump, I would just jump,
mm-hmm.
you know, and there was no room left for her. There's no room left for anything.
Yeah.
And I didn't really know what was going on. And I think I was just having a shutdown at one point and just kind of freaked out and ended it all and didn't know what was wrong with me. This system somehow didn't fit with me at all.
Mm-hmm.
And really, nothing was wrong. The system was wrong.
Yeah.
At the end of the day. Okay, next one. Dear Journal, about that young lady I told you about. The Sunday after I wrote what I did, the sermon on video was about a dating spirit. It is where you don't believe in dating or the quote-unquote boyfriend-girlfriend thing, but you are still giving pieces of your heart to people you don't know that God's planning for you to marry. I think that I've been that way. I need to not worry about who my wife is going to be yet. That is, I'm not supposed to be looking. God will wake me up at the right time and say, "Hey, Justin, look at her." So the person I wrote about is still very nice, but I'm currently catching some Z's until God says it is time to wake up. I feel like the world is just trying to eat me.
Mm.
I just have so much to pull together at the same time. My relationship with God, my relationship with mom, my relationship with dad, school and studying, mowing and lawn care. I mentioned a project that I was doing for my dad on the side. Bible study that I was attending, my own integrity is listed, my part-time job that I was doing for some side money, and an upcoming trip to Florida with my brother. I feel like these things are always staring at me. I do have fun, though. I have some things I look forward to. And this is what I did for my things that I look forward to. I know you can't see it, but it's a list that is indented and broken down, like, in bullet point style, like 1A, 2, lowercase a, 0.3B, 0.4C. And this is how I described the things that I looked forward to. On here I have church as a section, 1A, listening to teaching, 1B, helping Duggars, 1C, talking and joking with John David, 1D, talking with Josh, 1E, talking/fellowship. Clearly loved that stuff. I also listed, you know, doing stuff with computers, a airplane game that I was, a World War II airplane game that I was obsessed with. Here I say playing and reprogramming. So one of the things that I did with the computer game was, you know, you'd go on missions in these World War II planes and do combat, and the system would just put in these like fake AI names for all your wingmen,
mm-hmm.
and then all the enemies. And it would be like, oh, it's Hans Schmidt. Mm-hmm. And on your side, it's Joe Rolfe over there. And what I did was I went into the text file that had all those names in it,
mm-hmm.
and I filled the good guys with all my friends. And I put all the bad guys as my enemies. Anybody who had bullied me, anybody who had, you know, been mean to me through my childhood, or that I just plain didn't like. And we would just have these big air battles where me and my buddies are just demolishing all my enemies. And I think that was fun and cathartic for me.
It sounds very cathartic.
It's actually not a bad idea. Even now, I actually think that might be actually kind of nice to do. I might recommend that for anybody looking for a kind of a release of frustration.
Serious.
Bible study was on here. And then I said reading. And this is kind of a hint at like a general pattern that I'm into, which was I listed here World War II books, like nonfiction encyclopedic World War II nonfiction mm-hmm. history books. And that's because I was playing the World War II game. So, of course, I had to go all in and get all the books about World War II. I had to like go hard on that topic. Probably drove my mom crazy. I'm sure that she was like trying to slice potatoes and, you know, make dinner and things like that. And I probably just paced in a circle behind her reciting, you know, dates and timelines and figures. And like, you wouldn't believe how interesting the Africa campaign was and, you know, stuff like that. Probably literally reciting fuel like stats and mile like horsepower of, mm-hmm. of engines in planes to her. And I'm sure that's foreign to you. You don't ever have this.
I've never experienced
with me. Never.
You never go on tangents or, you know,
get
obsessed with things.
I definitely don't. I keep very very balanced in all of my ways. And then honestly, the next 7-8 pages are me just basically writing a business plan for the rest of my life, including things like income per year, taxes owed, savings allocations, investments.
I just love how heartfelt and sincere this whole journal is and how much it's just showing how much you care about these different things. Like, my journals were just me trying out like my first name with different boys' last names and writing who I had a crush on. And then, you know, I would do 2 entries in it and then forget about it for a year and then like do 1 and then just be like, oh, I need a new journal. I have to start all over. This isn't working.
Yeah. I mean, this was my friend. I mean, this was who I could talk to about things. And, you know, with my mind, honestly, I knew that people's eyes would glaze over if I started to describe things like this.
Mm-hmm.
And my journal's eyes never glazed over, you know, like it was somebody who I could just put words into. And like, it was just like, it felt personified to me, I think, at the time, like somebody that I could vent to and talk to without any judgment or like he's weird feelings.
Mm-hmm. And you felt safe, like, putting all these down in there? I think I just knew my brothers went through all my stuff. So I was really scared to actually put anything.
I was selectively paranoid. Like, I didn't want them to know about Jana, that Jana was the one. So I didn't put her name in here because I assumed people would get it. But the other stuff, I honestly didn't. It's not that I didn't care. I did, but I also, I don't know. I think I thought of it differently.
Yeah.
This is great. So as part of my business plan for the future, I wrote qualities that my wife needs in bullet points. Oh, boy. So let's see how you stack up, honestly.
How I do on this bingo.
Let's see how many we can cross off.
Oh.
My number one trait that my wife needed was patience, which is touching because, like, at the time, that's what I wanted most.
Mm-hmm.
Out of people was that they would be patient with me. And my idea of, like, I think that's part of why I was attracted to Jana was just she seemed like a quiet, patient person
mm-hmm.
who might be able to work with my pace. I didn't know, you know. So like, patience was something. You see, I have this starred love was important, gentleness. We're throwing in this one's submissiveness. That's there. It's that's what it says.
How'd that work out for you?
pretty great. faithfulness, reliance on Christ, a servant's heart, of course, hospitality, real Proverbs 31 vibes going on there.
Yeah, you're hitting all the classics.
All the classics. Kindness, joy and happiness in the Lord, desire to raise children, thoughtfulness and a servant's heart, added twice for emphasis, and then asterisk, this one was emphasized as being very important, and just understanding. Mm. I wanted somebody who would understand me. And then over here, there's kind of a quid pro quo thing going on, because I've got qualities that my wife needs, and then I said, I will give my wife.
Mm.
It's kind of a barter deal over here, so... I will give my wife a home, income, laughter slash happiness, comfort, ears to listen. But then I had to emphasize, lest the reader be confused, that these weren't just ears to listen, like on a plate.
Yeah.
These were actually my ears. So I have an arrow pointing to right before ears with the word my, so that people know that these are, in fact, the ones installed on my head. It's not like I'm giving them ears on, like, a plate. That would be weird. Asterisk, love and affection, a whole heart, peace, leadership, quality standards, time, a church home, and communication of love.
If you go back to, what was that? Oh, a whole heart. Was that, was that coming from the whole, like, not giving
pieces of your heart? Yeah.
Giving your, okay.
Right. Because if you give pieces, it's just simple math. If you've given, you know, if you cut your heart into 8 pizza slices, you give, you know, 1 slice to 3 girls or whatever. It's like, how many slices do you have left? You don't have to answer that. We don't have to answer that question now, but those are the kinds of deep philosophical musings I was thinking about at the time.
No, but that was very much a thing that was.
Yes.
Yeah.
Right. I will provide for my children love, discipline in love, spiritual teaching, fun slash laughter, time, schooling in a God-honoring place, church home, communication of love, high biblical standards, leadership, ears to listen, arms to hold, a mouth to comfort with. I think we went through this the first time through, and I feel like it really should have gone with words, like words to comfort with, but, you know, I was definitely, it was a part 1, 2, 3, it was all body parts, you know, we've got a theme. I meant it. I thought it sounded great at the time. Peace, home, and income or provision. And I have a big list of won'ts, stuff I will not do with my kids. And I won't speak, touch, or lash out in anger to my wife or children. I will never discipline in haste without making prominent my love. I won't allow my children to disrespect, disobey, or show dishonesty or pride from their time of infancy till they are on their own. I won't fail to talk with my wife daily. I won't fail to pray with my wife, for my wife, with my children, for my children. I won't think sinful thoughts. I won't lie to my family. I won't fail to teach or provide teaching of spiritual nature to my family. I won't fail to bless my family. I won't fail to provide physical needs to my wife and children, like a home and income. That's what I meant. I won't fail to teach my family courtship and biblical courtship. I kind of trailed off there. I won't fail to train my family in the ways of the Lord. I won't fail to be involved in my family's lives. I won't fail to be faithful to my wife and children and God. I won't fail to spend my blessings and gifts foolishly. Some context on that, and that's probably where we'll stop for this session. I had just found out, I think at this time, that Josh had been looking at porn, somehow involved in the Jim Holt campaign. People talk about it online as the sin in the camp thing, and, you know, Josh was basically brought in front of the church. And it was a huge deal. They were just getting ready to move. They were literally like packing boxes and stuff like that. And Jim had lost his race that he was doing. I think it was for U.S. Senate against Blanche Lincoln, I believe was the Democrat running. And he was the Republican nominee. I think he'd made it all the way to the general and he lost. Mm-hmm. And he was soul searching and trying to figure out why he had lost this campaign. And I don't know how Josh was found out. I think it was one of the kids that was around Josh when he was on the road with the campaign, one of the family children, maybe came across him and like said something very innocent sounding to their mom, like, you know, Joshy, which is what they called him, and which I hated. Joshy was looking at, you know, like naked pictures or people's nakedness or things like that is kind of what I heard.
Mm-hmm.
And that became huge. And I think Jim, probably this is an ego thing, if I had to guess, probably was grappling with why he lost mm-hmm. and couldn't accept the fact that it was him
mm-hmm.
and his message, which was extreme. Like he makes like the craziest of the crazy right-wing politicians today look kind of nuts with some of the stuff that he believed, honestly. And I'm not afraid of saying that, like that's it's true. Like, I made no bones about it. Like, there are mm-hmm. things about Jim that I liked that, you know, like there were moments that we had, you know, because I ended up doing some stuff for him too that were very nice on a personal level. But belief-wise, yeah, nuts. It was bad.
Mm-hmm.
And he clearly lost the race because he was just not, you know, a good candidate. But they, I think he found out about this and kind of did some two and two together kind of stuff in his head. And, you know, there was some Old Testament stories about the Israelites, I believe,
yeah.
failing in some mm-hmm. of their battles because there was sin in the camp. There was stuff going on in their literal war camp that they attributed this to. And then once they rooted it out and took care of it, they could be blessed
mm-hmm.
and they could, God was going to give them the good stuff. And so Jim holds like rack in his head. He finds out that Josh is looking at porn and puts two and two together. And it's like, well, look at this. Josh looking at porn. This was told to the church body that I was sitting in. I'd never seen anything like this before because I went to normal churches previously.
Mm-hmm.
I'd never seen somebody stand up and be like, Josh is being punished for the sin of this and he shall now confess to the people in front of you and like all this stuff. It was like crazy to me. Never seen anything like it. But Josh was basically, there was a man who was in the church who I guess had also done some quote unquote stuff, maybe porn related. Maybe he was a self-identified porn addict. And they arranged for Josh to basically go to his property, which was out in the sticks, and have him dig out a pond.
Hmm.
Now that might sound weird to some people, like digging out a pond, but this is Arkansas, Northwest Arkansas. There's anybody who's got more than like 10 acres has probably got a dugout pond that they waited to fill with rainwater and then stocked with some fish, and it's for the cows to drink out of.
Mm-hmm.
It's just in fields. And sometimes these ponds don't hold water. In fact, when we were growing up, we had a pond that wouldn't hold water, and we had to like fill it full of you know, special clay-like stuff that would seal the bottom of it. Okay. So that rainwater would stay in and it wouldn't just like drain and then form those like goopy cracks like the Sahara at the bottom.
Mm-hmm.
So Josh went to this guy's property and they had the idea that he was going to excavate by hand all that sludge in this basically failed, couldn't hold water pond.
Mm-hmm.
And they came up with this allegory in their head that the sludge was the sin and that Josh would kind of go in and start cleaning that stuff out. And the whole time he's going to be thinking about the Lord and he's going to walk out of this not wanting to look at naughty, bad stuff on the internet again.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what they did. They sent him there and there's a real humiliation that happened because this is language that they use is brokenness, the language mm-hmm. of brokenness. You'll see in the Bible things like humble yourself before God
yeah.
or, you know, we desire to be broken before you, Lord, mm-hmm. like things like that. And so they were like, well, we need to like cut this guy down to size and make sure that he's like on his bottom rung as a person, self-esteem wise and everything else. So we're going to send him out to this pond. He's not going to contact any of the family. It's going to be strict cutoff. Nobody talks to him. We talk about him in church, like the Josh update every week while he's out there.
And how long about?
Weeks.
So it's basically just like a temporary shunning or excommunication
yes.
while he was out there.
Oh, absolutely. And it was weeks. I mean, you just imagine he gets up every day, talks to no one. This church guy that I talked about who had, I think, a couple of kids and his spouse brings out a plate of food basically sets it there like a prisoner, gives it to him. Doesn't talk to him, by the way, during that whole time. Mm-hmm. Like, it sort of like silently walks up, puts the food down, walks back. Josh, his head completely shaven down to just a shiny bald head, steps out. I don't know if he was staying in a camper or if they had like a little shack or a tent. I don't know what it was. I think it was a shack or something. He'd step out, eat the food, probably up early in the morning at a certain time, went out and got a shovel and a wheelbarrow and started digging every day. Just arms sore. He gained a lot of muscle mass.
That's brutal.
He gained a lot of muscle mass over that. I met him beforehand, and like he came back afterwards and was like, after it was all over and his hair was growing back, he was like showing people his grip and like, you know, all that stuff. Cause he had, it was a serious workout.
Mm-hmm.
And every single week on Sunday, they gave a report on Josh to the entire church. Moms, dads, kids, different families.
So f***ed up. Like, yeah, it really is.
It is. I mean, the resentment you've got to mm-hmm. feel after that, it's got to be huge.
Yeah, like public humiliation.
Yeah.
You know?
And so people would like it was usually the guy who was hosting him that would, like, Josh wouldn't come to church.
Mm-hmm.
So this guy would stand up and he would go like, he's doing good, I think. I'm dropping him food, walking away. He's working diligently. You know, we prayed about it and like we're gonna have a conversation on this day where he can talk and kind of report back what's going on. I think that Jim Bob and John David would go out and see him sometimes. I don't know if Michelle did, to be honest. She was really emotional about this whole thing the whole time, just crying and just devastated. And what I didn't know at the time was that Josh had this background of having molested his sisters.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't know that. But apparently, a lot of the men in the church knew this. And so the rehab, like the intensity of this, was clearly because they were worried about the 360 view of all of Josh's stuff. It wasn't just molestation. It was all of it. He just keeps going back to the sex stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And they never mentioned molestation to the body. There's too much risk of a kid saying something or somebody visiting church who doesn't know anything. Like, they stuck with porn. And even though the molestation thing was a couple years prior, I think it was the context that led to the severity of and the seriousness with which he was treated for this. Because I think they saw him as like ordained almost. Like it was like God's future for this guy was that he use his gifts in politics and his gift of talking and all that to win hearts. And mm-hmm. that God was like, Josh was failing so huge because honestly, Satan didn't want him to succeed. It was like, This guy's going to be a giant someday. So God, you know, of course Satan's going to try to like knock him down. So yeah, like we all have to be there to make sure that that doesn't happen. So, mm-hmm. you know, f- you Satan, we're going to make sure this guy actually makes it.
Mm-hmm.
And the other thing that was happening too is the timing couldn't have been worse because there was a special planned for during that entire time that Josh was at the pond. They were filming the two things, the moving in of the house and Michelle's pregnancy and birth of Johanna.
Okay.
And so it's not like crews were around filming everything that they did.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't like that. It was very scheduled and very like on the calendar. It was like
once a week or
not even. It was like, okay guys, so just so you all know, we're gonna have the camera crews around early this month for this week.
Okay.
And they're going to just capture a bunch of stuff. We've filled the calendar with little kind of bogus activities to do. I say that sardonically. Some of them were probably natural, but it was very intense. It was like, okay, we're going to go hit up, you know, we're going to go bowling on this day. We're going to go do this in the afternoon and this. It was like a shoot.
Mm-hmm.
Like they kind of had like an idea of what they wanted.
Yeah.
And so they would just arrange all this stuff. Like even they filmed some of the construction at the house which Jim Bob was working on like a little bit at a time while they were at these little tiny houses. And they kind of brought the cameras in, and it was just sort of like, all right, everybody, you know, grab a hammer and make it look like you're working, and, you know, sit here and carry a piece of wood from here to here and set it down like it matters. Like, you know, just like uselessly transporting a 2x4 kind of thing. And just being like, okay, don't look at the camera. And actually, Josh filmed a lot of this stuff too himself. Like, he didn't, because he was like at camp, obviously. But there were a couple of times where he had to come back for filming because they didn't want this to be a part of the TLC show. And really, the only evidence that you can see in those specials that Josh was going through something was his head was just shaved. He was bald as and I actually have a picture on my phone.
Oh, that, really?
Yeah, that I'll show you. There he is.
Oh, yeah.
That's a screenshot I took a long time ago. You can't find these specials online anymore, by the way.
Oh, really?
If you can, I haven't found it. But when I took that screenshot, like, you could still, like, catch him on YouTube and stuff. So, yeah, that's him. With that shaved head. Josh's demeanor always struck me as kind of weird, because he was actually a pretty thoughtful, like, not too cheesy guy when, like, he and I would talk one-on-one, like, behind the house or something. But he was really weird coming back from the pond. He was almost shameless, and it really struck me. And I think I spent so much time writing in my journal about what I wanted to be to my family and, like, reaffirming my commitments, because I was seeing this guy that was really kind of freaking me out. And he, like, it was the kind of thing where he came back and it was like, we hadn't seen him in weeks. We've been hearing about all his every day. Like, the Duggar girls, bless their hearts, were crying every time there was a Josh update, just sobbing. You know, Michelle crying, Jim Bob, you know, he's just Jim Bob. But, you know, it was really emotional. And then Josh comes back for, like, a visit, and he's like, hey, guys, what's up? Kind of, like, you know, real, like, chill. And it was like, what?
Yeah.
I was like, what? Like, dude. And by the way, that betrothal thing, over. Done. And like everything else in that circle, like, you just gotta eat the awkwardness, you know. Like, those Duggar girls who found out later, you know, were abused by Josh, you know, they had to be there for everything. Every time he came back to the house, they're there. There's no sense of, like, they're being triggered by all this Josh talk. There's no sense of, like, whatever. I mean, I saw girls hugging girls and, like, you know, like, squeezing them a little tighter as stuff is going on. I saw, like, kind of this, like, support group going on. But I think in my head, I was just like, girls are emotional.
Yeah.
But looking back on it, it really strikes me how emotional they were during this time. Like, they were a wreck. But Josh was not. He came back. Literally all the men wanted to talk to him. Like, he was just like, hey, man, like, he could just make in conversation with all the patriarchs, all the men of the church.
Okay, so you're saying they wanted to talk to him like everything was normal, basically.
Yeah, it was okay. All normal discourse, like, you know, go get food from the buffet, and, like, Josh holding his plate of Frito-Lays or whatever, and, you know, acting like normal. And I think the rule was that as long as the cameras were around, Josh could kind of talk and interact with people like normal. So he took that opportunity to, like, be really normal. And then when the cameras are gone, he was closed mouth, like, couldn't talk. It was done. Like, he was back to lockdown. And the thing that bugs me, and has always bugged me, is that the producers that were there during that time were kind of there through that entire day. You know, they would like get there early with me. I would, like, be sitting on, like, a bench next to one of them while they're just, like, fiddling with their phone or whatever. It's like maybe two or three guys. You know, the main producer guy had, like, a little handheld camcorder and, like, a boomed guy and a dude with a nicer, bigger camera. That was it. And, like, they saw all this weird stuff with Josh. They had to have. There had to have been little kids that come up and just be like, Joshy looked at someone naked. or something like that. Mm-hmm. It would literally be impossible for them to not have had something weird going on. Like, to be like, something is rotten in Denmark, and this place is really culty, and, like,
yeah,
this is freaking me out. It should have freaked him out.
Mm-hmm.
It was weird. And it was right there. And yeah, the rule was like, Josh, don't f this up for us. You know, you can talk and be normal. And I think it was the understanding that nobody needs to tell the producers about any of this or mention it or, you know, behave yourselves. Don't bring up Josh kind of stuff. And to them, like the message I had as a kid was, it's because it's a ministry.
Mm. Yeah.
And Satan is attacking the ministry by attacking Josh. Therefore, you're letting Satan win if, you know, Satan tries this other attack. And, like, from the world's viewpoint, this is all horrible and bad. But, like, from God's perspective, you know, this is, like, his will and it's happening and unfolding the way that he wants. And, you know, the outsiders, the world doesn't understand what goes on here. So, you know, we need to just say they don't need to know because, like, whatever. And, like, yeah, I bought that hook, line, and sinker as a kid. But now as an adult, I look at it and I go, ugh.
Yeah, the mental gymnastics of that perspective.
Yeah.
You know, it's just.
There had to have been some conversations between Jim Bob and producers about how to handle Josh. How to cut around him. What's going on. I don't know if Jim Bob just sort of minimized it and said, like, he looked at some bad stuff and, you know, we're Christians and, like, you know, he's just going through some discipline or whatever, some, like, boot campy kind of stuff, you know, like alert kind of stuff or whatever. But I mean, the context was clearly molestation and now the kids were starting to repeat stuff and we're starting to see a pattern and holy, what do we do?
Yeah.
I mean, it was a big deal. It consumed the church.
It's so interesting because, you know, the church that I went to in my, gosh, I think we started going there when I was 15 or 16, was very, very, very conservative and pretty fundamentalist. But we didn't have the confessing before the church, you know, I mean, the whole church would know about stuff, but it was, you know, via gossip, not, hey, we're bringing you before the church and shaming you.
It was very, like, kind of medieval.
Yeah.
It's weird. But yeah, no confession. It was regular. And it wasn't just Josh. It was like other men regularly coming in front of the church.
I was going to ask you about that. Like, how often?
Every week.
Every single week? Was it like a kind of an assigned portion of the church
of the
Sunday
cadence.
Service?
Kind of. It was like there was a place to put it if you needed to. You know, it was like somewhere like between the singing and everything else and the main message,
mm-hmm.
which they didn't really preach. It was usually like, let's put in a VHS of Bill Gothard or something like that, you know?
Oh, really?
Yeah, there weren't really preachers. There were every now and then. A lot of times they were guest preachers. Like I remember Anna Keller, you know, who's Anna Duggar.
Okay.
Her dad coming in and doing a sermon, and it was the freakiest thing I'd ever heard. It was like about how Satan was the wizard in The Wizard of Oz. Yeah.
I'll be thinking about that. <for
this thing. laughs> just think
be
about that.
To, like, oh, okay.
It was about how Satan was the wizard in The Wizard of Oz, and like how The Wizard of Oz was like this, just I think he was trying to break the next Harry Potter. I think he was trying to be like, y'all, you think Harry Potter's bad, like it's been here the whole time, like
it's been in front of us this whole time.
Listen, guys, this is a work of Satan, demonic, and I don't know what it was. It was just like, it was a weird sermon. That's all I remember about that. So they would have guest people come in and speak, and somewhere between like the music, which was all homeschoolery, kind of like violin, everybody played the violin or the piano,
mm-hmm.
And then the sermon, there was like confession time, and it was very dark. It was very like, usually the dads of the group getting up, while, and a lot of times their wives would be made to kind of stand behind them and like off to the side and like just kind of hang their heads or just try to like maintain eye contact with everybody and not speak, because, you know, women speaking in the church, but they would just kind of be like standing by their man in front of the church while he's like, I've been struggling with my anger, and it was usually anger or lust, or I've given in to my flesh or whatever, and like struggled with, you know, Satan tempting my flesh kind of thing and giving in, and I need the church's support. And usually the elders of the church would come around and put a hand on them. Sometimes they go grab some crappy canola oil or whatever and rub it on their head.
Oh gosh.
You know, anoint them with oil, as they did in the Bible times. I'm sure they used Walmart brand canola oil.
Oh gosh.
But anyway, they would do that. They would all lift him up in prayer.
Yeah.
And I gotta say, it was such a bro fest.
Yeah. I was just gonna say that, like, yeah, so of course they're all just like, hey man, we get it when Josh is doing shit.
We got you, bro.
Yeah. We get it. We all struggle. It's also funny how externalized it is.
Yeah.
You know, it's all, my flesh was tempted by Satan, or, you know, spiritual battles were being waged over me last night.
Yeah.
Or, you know, those are all things I remember hearing.
It's kind of like, I'm a high value target for the devil. You know what I mean? I'm a man. I'm a high value target.
I'm a big threat.
I'm kind of a big deal. And Satan's over there just like, whoa, we got to shut this guy down. Show him some boobs.
Yeah. And it's like, it's just hilarious. Like, the layers to that are just kind of hilarious. But like, you, you're making it all about something, over-spiritualizing it, when really you're just a shitty person who's not practicing. One, you know, maybe not practicing self-control, but also we're shaming people for very normal things.
Yeah, but you know what was funny is that it was always, every time a man would get up and confess, it was always the kids out front, intermingled in the audience as you're talking, and your wife standing beside you. And there was no talk about what it was exactly that it meant for you to lose your shit in anger.
Yeah.
What did that mean?
Yeah.
Because we know it's fine to spank.
Mm-hmm.
We know it's fine to beat your kids with a rod. By the way, parents would swap ideas on what kind of implement to hit their kids with.
Yeah, same.
They would be like, well, right here, I got this one's made out of pure maple. Like, just sanded down. Feel that finish. Isn't that great? Oh, yeah. No, bruises every time kind of a thing. And it was like, you know, some of them were like, oh, yeah, mine has a nice little leather, like, wrapped thing so you can hang it next to the fridge. Some people loved using paint sticks from Home Depot. You know, those, like, dipper sticks, stirrers, like those ones. Get the extra long ones. Some people would use, there's one family, I thought this was sick, to be honest. They would get really kind of long, like foot long, hot melt glue sticks.
That you put in the glue gun?
That you put like in the glue gun. And they were thick, they were long, it was like commercial grade. And they would buy packs of those and take one of those and just swat kids across the legs or the butt. You know, like, we're talking 17, 18 years old.
Yeah.
Down to like toddlers, babies even.
Yeah.
And I don't think they use the hot milk glue sticks on babies. I mean, who knows? You know, but yeah, no, you were getting beat. And us boys who were older, the idea was that we would just kind of amongst ourselves around 14, 15, you're becoming a man. So your thing was to like shove off the pain as you're getting beat.
Mm-hmm.
Don't say anything. Don't make a move. Don't make a sound while you're getting, you know, whacked. And yeah, so I think I posted online that I thought the Duggars were like pretty mild for the church circle. Like, that the Duggars weren't mild. It was within the church circle. There was definitely a lot of aggression by the dads. And so, you know, usually when they would be like, oh man, I really lost my shit in anger kind of thing, you know, God needs to forgive me of that. It had to have been something serious that they did in anger. Mm-hmm. 'Cause it's like, that doesn't just mean nothing.
Yeah.
In that circle, you know, 'cause they've got righteous wrath and the not so good wrath. And honestly, the not so good wrath was just domestic violence.
Yeah. And it's frustrating because you've literally kind of built up the system that works for you. So you can do these things to your kids or your wife or, you know, and then you can go and just do this little thing.
To do Toastmasters.
Yeah. Do Toastmasters. Be vague. You know, minimize it. And then just be guilt-free because God forgives me, you know, and all of you that I just hurt should too.
And they were so nice about everything. If somebody was like, oh, I beat my family, that like, they would just be like, aw, you poor thing. And it was very much like a, like, not only would they do the thing in front of the church, but the men would be like, oh, dude, let's get coffee, man. Mm. Like, let's get coffee. I've been there. I beat my family last year. You know, like, we can relate. Like, let's talk about how I learned to not beat my family as often, you know? And it was like, talks like that. And honestly, I think the sexual stuff, same vein.
Yeah.
Same freaking vein. It was treated as one of those things that just happened.
Yeah.
It just happened. It was just normal.
When you have this whole environment where you can't look at anything, you can't do anything because you're just going to immediately fall into some sort of sexual sin.
Yeah.
Like, it's just promoting the idea that it's really not your fault because you can't control yourself. It's just happening to you.
Right. You can't control yourself. Satan's after you because you're a high value target because you're doing stuff for God. Mm-hmm. And he hates that. He hates that you're God's employee of the month. And yeah, you're given a fast pass to just resolve on this stuff. And forgive, you know, what were the women, girls, and kids taught at this time? Forgive and respect.
Yes.
Forgive and respect. Yeah. Forgive and respect.
Yep.
Now, don't you give your dad a weird look because he beat you. Don't give your mom a weird thought on this. But your brother molested you? Well, you had better, you know.
You need to forgive him.
You need to forgive him and not act like a around him in the future. And sorry if we're, you know, being kind of flippant with this stuff. I think it's really upsetting. And, you know, it is an important, sensitive topic. And it's just incredibly upsetting. Yeah. I think we both saw this.
We both experienced this. Yeah.
And so this is what we mean, I think, when we say like a grooming or abuse or control framework, is that the system was kind of pretty sweet if you were the patriarch.
Yeah.
And if you weren't, well, tough cookies. Like, your life revolves around them.
Yeah.
And that's how it was.
Yeah. You're taught that from a very, very young age.
Yeah. Well, we are probably at the point where we need to wrap this first episode.
Yeah.
And probably take a little break for, you know, a good couple weeks here before recording another one, because this has just been crazy. And honestly, you know, as much as we're talking about this now, honestly, we probably don't go over this in this amount of detail or intensity this often. So, you know, we'll probably take a little detox from this stuff for a little bit, and then, you know, kind of jump back into the journal and you know, reflecting and hopefully, you know, educating and providing some perspective for people who don't know, and, you know, maybe some, I don't know, something to relate to for people who grew up the same way as us.
Yeah.
But, you know, we love you guys. Like, be well. You know, let's raise awareness about this shit, you know. Let's make sure people know what they're supporting when they sit and watch a well-behaved family of people who love the Lord on TV. Because somebody's getting hurt.
Yeah.
And people need to realize that this isn't a victimless industry.
No. No. Yeah.
So anyway, thank you guys so much for listening. We will talk to you soon.
That was a good talk. So...
All right. Till next time, guys. Bye.
Bye.